Greetings and welcome back to Room 303 in AP Senior English, and we now turn to our study of the Iliad, book number 7, Ajax Duels with Hector. Now on LearnStrong.net, if you haven't been following our lectures, we've already covered Iliad 1 through 6. Iliad 1, the invocation to the muse, of course, the battle between Achilles and Agamemnon. Iliad 2, that's the bad dream sent from Zeus to Agamemnon that says, hey, it's okay, the Greeks are going to win today. We also have the cataloging of the great troops, catalog of ships, catalog of chariots. Book 3, finally Paris and Menelaus go at it, and we think that the war is over because Menelaus has defeated Paris, but book 4, no, we've got Zeus and Hera, and finally we've got the Pandarus shot to Menelaus that will start the war all over again. Book 5, we've got what we call the Diomedes Aristeia, that notion, the Aristeia is a type. We're going to see this again in this book. That's why it's important for your notes. A kind of typeset of a certain kind of battle scene where the hero is going to shine. And of course, Diomedes will jack both Aphrodite as well as Ares in that book. Book 6, we are a pivotal book where with Hector back in the walls of Troy, with his wife, with his son, and of course, finally with Paris. Now again, the hope is that you are annotating on your own, you're using our learning theory of connecting new information to old information, and then of course at our three levels of reading, you're paying attention at level 1 to summary, at level 2, what does the text mean, 2A themes, messages, 2B, again that's that rhetorical component. We're studying specifically symbolism and irony, and we'll look for that here in this book. And then finally at level 3, how can I relate this to the information that I already know at 3A to other texts, and finally at 3B to ourselves. Let me give a brief overview of Book 7 really quickly. The war is going to continue. Hector will call for a one-on-one and will taunt the Greeks. None of the Greeks want to do it. Finally, we'll have Ajax who will step forward after a speech by Nestor, and he's kind of almost like shamed into it. And it's a draw fight. And then we're going to have, once again, Nestor. In some ways, Nestor gets some of the important lines of this book, 7. We're then going to have Nestor who will say, it's time we do 3 things. We need to bury our dead, we need to build a wall, a defensive wall, and then finally we need to build a ditch around that wall to protect ourselves at the ships. The Trojans will meet after the duel that ends in a draw, and they will decide, you know what, let's try and make an overture to end this thing. The original plan is give Helen back. Paris says no, but he says, I will give back all the treasure that I stole when I stole Helen. That offer is made to the Greeks, and the Greeks say no, and then finally the long day ends. I mean, if you'll think about it, we saw Zeus and Hera in bed together at the end of book 1. And then the second book would begin a new day, and of course we're going to have a whole lot that happens throughout that day, culminating of course here in book 7. All right, let's go ahead now and look at some of the opening lines. As I've said in prior lectures, I would love to be able to read all of this with you, I just can't. But let's at least get a sense of it. The opening lines, vaunting a flash in arms. Hector swept through the gates with his brother Paris keeping pace beside him. Both men bent on combat. On they fought, and then we'll get an epic simile. Like wind when a god sends down some welcome blast to sailors desperate for it. Worked to death at the polished oars, beating the heavy seas, their arms slack with the labor. So, and that's how an epic simile works. You always have the at like or the as, and then you have the word so. So welcome that brace of men appeared to the Trojans, desperate for their captains. And then right away, we'll begin to have what by line 19 is called rampaging Trojans. So we're going to have Paris with a kill, we're going to have Hector with a kill, we're going to have Glaucus with a kill. And then finally, that's going to lead to Athena and Apollo having a conversation. And Athena, after a few back and forths, will say at line 38, 39 to Apollo, so be it, archer of the sky, when he says, you know, maybe we need to just back away here. And she says, those were my very thoughts, winging down from Olympus in the midst of Trojans and Achaeans. But tell me, she says, how do you hope to stop men from fighting? It's an interesting question, right? And this whole poem seems to, in some way, be about that one, like, right, you know, what is it that we can do? We're told then at roughly line 49, Apollo staged the action, her eyes afire, the goddess Pallas did not resist a moment. She flashes the word in Helenus's mantic spirit, the soothsayer who's also a brother of Hector. The son of Priam sends what pleased the immortals, hatching instant plans, and then he says to Hector, son of Priam, a master man like Zeus, listen to me now, let your brother guide you, have all the Trojans and Argives take their seats, and you challenge Achaia's best, bravest man to duel in bloody combat to the death. It's not the hour to meet your doom, not yet. I heard a voice of the gods who live forever. And when Hector hears this about the challenge, then he rejoices. And so we then got the idea of the challenge, the one-on-one challenge. Hector will step up between the battle lines in the same way that he did in Book 3 when he said, we're going to go ahead and have my brother fight against Menelaus. And he makes that challenge. And it's fascinating that all of the Greeks are afraid. Nobody wants to step forward. Menelaus finally will do it because, of course, he is the reason we're all here anyway, his wife, you know, being taken away. And he's ready to step forward. And then at line 125, Agamemnon will step up and say, "You are mad, my prince." He's talking to his brother Menelaus. "No need for such an outburst. Get a grip on yourself, distraught as you are. Just for the sake of rivalry, soldiers' pride, don't rush to fight with a better man, with Hector, the son of Priam. Many others shrink before him, even Achilles." It's interesting, we got to mention every once in a while Achilles, because we're forgetting that he's sitting, of course, back behind the lines. "Even Achilles dreads to pit himself against him." Ironic, given, of course, what we know is going to happen later in the Iliad, right, when they fight out on the battle lines where men win glory, Kleos, right? "Achilles, far and away a stronger man than you. Go back, sit down with the comrades you command. We'll put up another champion to go against this Hector. Fearless is he, and never sated with fighting. He'll gladly sink to a knee and rest, I'd say, if the man comes through alive from the fight he begs for, dueling to the death." So it's at that point then that the old man Nestor steps up, and he basically gives a powerfully shaming speech where he says basically, if only, line 153, "Oh, if only Father Zeus, Athena, Apollo, I were young again." And then over at line 183, he says, "Oh, make me young again, and the strength inside me steady as a rock. Hector with that flashing helmet would meet his match in a combat in a moment. You, the bravest of all Achaeans, and not one with the spine to battle Hector face to face." We're told that the old man's taunts work. 9 different Greeks stand up. Lots go into a helmet. They scratch information on a little rock and put it inside of a helmet. And it kind of reminds you of the lots selection for who would throw first in Iliad 3, right? When Menelaus and Paris fight. And then out comes Ajax. And Ajax is going to be the one who then will fight. And we've got all kinds of interesting. They both get ready for the battle, their battle prep and all of that. And then finally we're ready to go. I'll pick up with this one at roughly line 258. "And now, holding that great shield before his chest, Ajax marched right up to Hector, threatening with his deep resounding voice." Obviously, before we fight, we got to have the talking, right? "Hector, now you'll learn, once and for all in combat, man to man, what kind of champions rage the Argive ranks, even besides Achilles." Notice Achilles keeps getting mentioned in this book. "That lion heart who mauls battalions wholesale, often his beat seagoing ships, Achilles lies, raging away at Agamemnon, marshal of armies. But here we are, strong enough to engage you and plenty of us too. Come, lead off if you can with all your fighting power." It's interesting that Ajax feels like he has to mention Achilles and remind him that Achilles is back there sitting pouting because of Agamemnon. Immediately, of course, makes us think about Paris, doesn't it? "A flash of his helmet as rangy Hector shook his head. Ajax, royal son of Telamon, captain of armies, don't toy with me like a puny, weak-kneed boy or a woman never trained in works of war. War, I know it well, and the butchery of men, well I know. Shift to the left, shift to the right, my tough-tanned shield. That's what the real drill, defensive fighting, means to me. I know it all, how to charge in the rush of plunging horses. I know how to stand and fight to the finish, twist and lunge in the war god's deadly dance. On guard, big and bluff as you are, I've no desire to hit you sniping in on the sly. I'd strike you out in the open. Strike you now." And so we have the exchange. Hector is actually wounded in this exchange, but ultimately they do fight to a standstill, and both sides will offer truce. And ultimately, they do decide to end this thing. At roughly line 320, you'll have the herald Aetius who will make the observation. He says, "No more, my sons. Don't kill yourselves in combat. Zeus, who marshals the storm cloud, loves you both. You're both great fighters. We all know that full well. The night comes on at last. Best to yield tonight." But the giant Ajax answered briskly, "Wait, Aetius. Tell Hector here to call the truce. Mad for a fight, he challenged all our bravest. Let him lead off. I'll take his lead. You'll see. His helmet flashed as Hector nodded. Yes, Ajax. Since God has given you power, build and sense, you are the strongest spearman of Achaea. Let us break off this dueling to the death, at least for today. We'll fight again tomorrow until some fatal power decides between our enemies, handing victory down to one side or other. Look, the night comes at last. Notice we keep saying this, at last, right? It's been a while. It's been a lot that's been packed into one day, right? Best to yield tonight, so you will bring some joy to Achaea's forces camped beside their ships, and most of all to their own troops, the comrades of command. But I'll go back to the great city of King Priam and bring some joy to the men of Troy and Trojan women trailing their long robes. The idea of robes keeps coming back again and again. Thankful for my return, they'll go to meet the gods and sing their praises. Come, let us give each other gifts, unforgettable gifts, so any man may say, Trojan soldier or Argive, first they fought with heart-devouring hatred, then they parted, bound by pacts of friendship. It's a remarkable thing. So they're going to start out jacking and killing on each other, wanting to kill each other, and they're going to end up, can we say this, mutual respect, yes? At this point, Nestor gets another speech. He makes four important suggestions. He says, first of all, we need to pause the fighting. Take a little break. Two, he says, we need to bury and burn our dead. We got a lot of dead bodies lying around all over the place. Third, we need to make a defensive wall around our ships to defend ourselves. And then finally, we need to dig a defensive trench or a ditch right in front as well. Now, all of this is going to play heavily into the book that will follow in Book 8, because, of course, ultimately, with the help of the allowance of Zeus, these Trojans are going to make it all the way to those Greek ships, right? Meanwhile, back in Troy, we've got a fascinating scene, right? Antor is going to make a suggestion. Let's end this thing, right? We're on line 397. And now, the Trojans, collected high on the crest of Troy, they were shaken, distracted men at Priam's gates. But the clear-headed Antenor opened up among them. Hear me, Trojans, Dardans, all our royal allies. I must speak out what the heart inside me urges. On with it. Give Argive Helen and all her treasures back to Atreus' sons to take away at last. We broke our sworn truce. We fight as outlaws, true. And what profit for us in the long run? Nothing, unless we do exactly as I say. Now, this is fascinating. Of course, this could be the reference to, we should have never been fighting in the first place because it's against the rules to bring another man's wife back to our city and claim her as our prince's own. This could mean, of course, we're back to earlier when in Book 3 we had Menelaus defeat Paris, and yet the Trojans didn't admit that in fact it was done. And of course, it was a Trojan, Andaras, who broke the truce. He continued. So he pressed the point, then took his seat. But among them stood magnificent Paris. Now again, every time magnificent as an adjective is used, you have to kind of roll your eyes, right? Fair-haired Helen's lord. And he came back with a winging burst in answer. Notice it's Paris who will answer first. Stop, Antenor. No more of your hot insistence. It repels me. You must have something better than this to say. But if you are serious, speaking from the heart, the gods themselves have blotted out your senses. Now, I say this to our stallion-breaking Trojans. I say, no, straight out. I won't give up the woman. Sounding, of course, very much like Agamemnon about his prize, Chryseis, and as well, of course, Achilles with Briseis, right? But, he says, Paris, those treasures I once hauled home from Argos, I'll return them and add from my own stores. In other words, I'm going to try to appease the Greeks, and maybe they'll take some money and they'll finally leave. Of course, you know, you can kind of imagine how that one's going to go. By the way, Priam afterward will speak, and it's fascinating that Priam doesn't say, Paris, you're wrong. You're the reason that all these people have died. You're the reason, theoretically, our city could fall. We are giving Helen back and the treasure. That's the right plan. He doesn't do any of that. Instead, he says, I agree with Priam. Let's make overture to the Greeks. We will offer to them a treasure, right? In other words, we're basically going to try and pay them off, okay? The response by the Greeks is, of course, what you would pretty much imagine, and it's going to be to Diomedes to say it at line 461. Finally, Diomedes, lord of the war cry, shouted out, no one touch the treasures of Paris, Helen either. It's obvious. Any fool can see it. Now at last, the neck of Troy's is in the noose. Her doom is sealed. It's fascinating to read these lines closely. Did you notice what Diomedes just said? He said, even if they try to return Helen at this point, is over. We will not take her or any of the money back. All the Achaean soldiers roared out their assent, stirred by the stallion-breaking lord's reply, and King Agamemnon rounded on Idaeus, the herald for the Trojans. There's the Achaeans' answer, Idaeus, a declaration you can hear for yourself. It is my pleasure, too. But about the dead, I never grudge their burning, no holding back for the bodies of the fallen. Once they are gone, let fire soothe them quickly. This is my sworn pledge. In other words, I'll let you go ahead and bury your dead, even those dead that are, of course, very close to our ranks, to our tents and the ships and that kind of thing. The dead are burned with, we're told, a lot of tears, because of course this is that moment and finally a calming in all the fighting when you kind of come to terms with all the devastation and all the dead, and you're like, this is just really tragic. On top of all the dead for the Greeks, they will in fact erect a barrow or a wall, and then a trench is built, a defensive trench as well. They eat and they sleep, and it's finally the end in book 8. It's finally, book 7. It's finally the end then of a long, hard fought day. All right, let's finish really quickly. At 2a, well, you could make the argument that one of the major messages of this book has to do with this notion of equal warriors will earn respect by competing. And this is interesting for athletes who will often say this. Athletes will often say, I either want to go up against somebody who's my equal or somebody who's my better, not somebody who's my lesser, because it doesn't mean anything to me, right? Also, we should point out that there's a very interesting message here that says the Greeks are going to continue to fight even if Helen is returned and all the treasure is returned. In other words, Helen may just be the excuse for these Greeks. What is it they want? They want what's inside the walls of Troy, don't they? That's what they're really fighting for. At 2b, well, it's interesting what symbols we can play with here. One obvious symbol is that money that Paris says, we'll just throw money at the Greeks and they'll accept the money and the treasure and they'll be done with it, right? Of course, for the Greeks, they got no interest in being paid off. Notice how Paris thinks, I want the girl, I don't care if a whole lot more people have to die, and of course, ultimately, who will die? His brother, the great warrior of Hector, and then the great warrior Hector, and then beyond that, of course, Troy itself is going to fall, right? The irony that we can maybe see at 2a here has to do with, of course, two warriors in Ajax and Hector, who are two of the greatest, who are going to start out as enemies, taunting and ridiculing each other, but through a rough and hard contest, finally come to call each other friends and to exchange gifts, right? At 3a, well, this is the accumulation, of course, of several books of the Iliad. It's like we've kind of come to this, you know, to this point where finally we can have a little bit of rest, a little bit of food, a little bit of wine at the end of a long, long, hard-fought day with all kinds of things happening. Of course, this is a compression of time. It's impossible that all these things could happen within just this period of time, but it gives you kind of a sense of all of the craziness that's been going on, which does beg an interesting question to 3a. What for you is the text which best represents two equals fighting it out? And finally, when they get to the end of their contest, they have to accept the fact that they are, in fact, both equals. There is no winner. And to that degree, they end up kind of resolving it and even calling each other friends. Well, at 3b, obviously the question personally is, when was a time that you were involved in a struggle with an equal? And it was so equal in your struggle that you finally found yourself saying, you know what, instead of my enemy, I think I'm going to respect you. I may not call you my friend, but I will respect you enough that I'm willing to say, all right, all right, all right, we're not going to fight anymore. That's how book 7 ends. Book 8 will begin, the tide of battle turns, is how Phagos will title this one. And this one will be, of course, the rise of the Trojans. The Greeks will really begin to learn what defeat is. And of course, this is the promise that Zeus will have given to Thetis, that yeah, ultimately the Trojans are going to kill a whole lot of Greeks. Ultimately, we know that Achilles is going to come back, but let's go ahead and say it out loud. By book 8, we will begin with the beginning of the end. That is to say, we know that Patroclus's life will soon be in the balance. Before that, we got a little bit more fighting to do. I hope you'll come back and have our conversation with Book 8. Thank you.